to change my life. So I decided to sign up into the military. And then after the military, I was able to go into the New York City Police Department, and I rose to the top of the police department fairly quickly. I was a commanding officer of the 67th Precinct. I was the first black commander there in the history of the New York City Police Department. If you follow the law, you can succeed. I'm talking about L. Look for opportunities. Whatever you want to do, look for your opportunities. Then the A is you gather information and analyze it. And then the W is work toward getting it done. Welcome to Corey Pegues Live television show. I'm here with the distinguished retired lieutenant in the New York City Police Department and now Dr. Darren Porcher. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me here.
Yeah. Hey, and you get the prize because you're the first guest.
Well, it's an honor to be sitting in this seat. I'm sure we have a lot of things that we can go over throughout the course of this session.
Oh, yes. Well, let's just jump right into it. I know a lot about you. How about you? Let's talk to the people. Let them know. Give them a little background about where you grew up, your experience in policing, and your education, your background.
Sure. My name is Darren Porcher. I grew up in housing projects in the Bronx. And as I moved to different places, lived in different sections of the Bronx, I went to high school in the Bronx. And after graduating from high school, I enlisted into the U.S. military on active duty. I did a four-year stint in the military. Upon completion of 4 years, that's when I went to the United Nations. I worked at the UN for a year. And after working there, I look back on a lot of my experiences in growing up in the Bronx in terms of policing. I said, wow, you know what? I think that's something that I can do. Let me give this a shot. So I took the police exam, subsequently became a police officer, and I worked in the NYPD for 20 years. In the 20 years that I worked in the NYPD, I worked in amalgamation. I had an amalgamation of different experiences. First, I started off working as a police officer in the South Bronx. Then I was a detective. Then I trained recruits in the police academy as a sergeant. In the Internal Affairs Bureau, I worked there as a lieutenant, commanding a team of sergeants, detectives, and police officers, and investigating police corruption. And then I ended my career in the Community Affairs Bureau. So throughout my time in the police department, it was interesting because I still maintained a presence in the military. I was an officer in the military. So initially I was on active duty, then I got a commission and I stayed in for 20 years. So simultaneously I worked in the police department. I was also a member of the US military as well. So that was kind of interesting because we look in terms of, you know, counterintelligence, efforts that have been conducted abroad, etc. I kind of had a hands-on pulse on what was going on with that. And it also assisted me in my day-to-day dealings within the NYPD. But just getting back to being in the NYPD, so I got my bachelor's degree, I got my master's degree, and I finished up my doctorate. I want to say the studies component while I was a member of the NYPD. And upon retiring at 20 years, that's when I did my doctorate at Fordham University. And I've since taken the show on the road, and I'm now a college professor. I teach at Monroe College and Pace University in New York City. And that's my story.
Wow, that's a great story. I mean,
you have a fantastic story yourself.
So. Yeah, but this is about you, it's not about me. I mean, as the audience, if you don't know, our careers pretty much mirror each other as far as background is concerned.
We got promoted to lieutenant at the same time.
Yes.
That's where we met. We got promoted to lieutenant.
We got promoted to lieutenant together in the early 2000s. You know what's funny?
Right after 9/11.
Right after 9/11. What I remember about that promotion, when I talk about, disparate treatment, they talk about minorities being promoted in the NYPD, the numbers of this, the numbers of that. Every time I think about when me and you got promoted to lieutenant,
How many blacks were promoted out of 55? It was about 55, and it was only you and me.
Yeah.
And I always think about that.
Yeah, that's true. But we were the only two in there.
We were the only two, but we were the only two that obviously at that point passed the test in defense of the NYPD. If you didn't pass the test, you wouldn't even be eligible.
It was civil service promotion.
It's a civil service promotion. Right.
But, you happened to be studying for captain at the time when we were going through the training component of being promoted to the rank of lieutenant.
Yeah, and you,
and you pushed me.
And you thought I was crazy.
No, I didn't think you were crazy. I had another plan. So.
Yeah, you had another plan. I just wanted to get to the top and fight with all of those chiefs and because I thought that I could do it.
Right.
And
well, apparently it came to fruition.
Ended up doing it. And that leads into my question I asked, and you could just expand a little bit on it. I was going to ask you, how was your experience in the NYPD overall? Like, did you experience biases, racism? Did anything happen in front of you that you had to, like, check people? I mean, I don't know if you said it. I was listening, but you were a law instructor in the police academy.
That's correct.
That's big because you're impressionable at that point. I remember being in a police academy and the instructors, you was at what rank?
I was a sergeant.
You was a sergeant. Even the cops, that are instructors, you know, we look up to them like they're God on earth when you're going to the police academy. I mean, you was in a supervisory position. So, you know, I'm pretty sure a lot of the cops, all ethnicities, was looking up to you like one day, I want to be where he was. So, like, how was your whole experience going through? Because some of us, like, my experience was I was the guy that most people didn't want to speak to in the room. And, you know, as I was going through the ranks because, like, I didn't play, like, the black-white jokes. You know, I was, you know, I would get to the scene, somebody get arrested. You know, I worked in different communities. I worked in minority communities. I worked in Astoria, which is all of the Greek community for the most part. But I always was like, listen, we got to treat everybody with respect, and you can't do these things in front of me because I'm going to tell. So, what was your experience in the NYPD for 20 years?
Well, I mean, I had an amalgamation of different experiences. And when we look at a lot of systemic problems that are within the police department, have I had those experiences? I'm sure I have. In terms of me pinpointing one particular instance where I can say, hey, look, you know what? Factually, this is what happened, and I can clearly state that this was on a platform of racism. I'm sure something like that did occur, but I, like yourself, I never in any way, shape, or form let that deter me from my goals.
Right.
Oftentimes, like in terms of jokes like black, white, or even, you know, jokes towards people of other ethnicities, gender, sexuality, et cetera, I really tried to keep myself in a place that was, I really tried to isolate myself from that as much as possible. And a lot of that is, I want to say it's driven by the individual, but oftentimes you set a presence. When you look at what you did in a police department, you were a commanding officer, and in many instances, the people that fall under your chain of command abide by your leadership. So you have some leaders, for example, that when people say, okay, he's all right, he's a good guy, and everyone is comfortable. And that will produce a certain type of officer, whereas you have another type of leader that's very astringent and, I should say, stern to the point where it's, look, I'm very focused on getting the job done, no nonsense. And that kind of, when you have that type of leader, the people beneath the that leader will abide by that leader's request or that leader's style in doing things. So I try to model myself as a person that was somebody that was focused on getting the job done, and tried to leave the ancillary issues such as, you know, these jokes and things of that effect.
Right.
I clearly left that on the outside because people saw me as a person. Remember, I worked in the Internal Affairs Bureau for a number of years. Right. As a lieutenant there, I was a manager that I had sergeants, detectives, and police officers that fell under my command. So what happens is upon leaving the Internal Affairs Bureau, the first thing people say is, okay, this is someone that came from Internal Affairs Bureau. So I can't really trust this person. But you know what? That was the best thing that could ever happen because that perception put me in a place where I didn't have to get into those interactions, those negative interactions with people to say, hey, look, this is not right, etc.
Right.
So just going back to your initial question in connection with what were my experiences, I want to say by and large they were good.
Right.
I created my situations as I progressed through my career.
Right.
And I think that's the key. You as an individual need to create your universe.
Mm-hmm.
If you look for someone else to create your universe, you constantly be unhappy.
Right. Great. And you know, you talked about leadership, and you know, I've read a lot of books on leadership. That was my thing. I personally like to go through the different leadership styles: autocratic, democratic, laissez-faire.
You went to Columbia for, if I'm not mistaken,
yeah.
There was a leadership course that the police department
right.
gave to executives.
Mm-hmm.
And not every executive was sent off to that training.
Oh, no,
so
it's
that
hard
was
to
something
get,
right
it's
exactly.
hard to get
so.
There. But I like the three different leadership styles because you know, and you can agree, sometimes you gotta have the laissez-faire attitude because it's just laid back.
Right.
You guys are just, you know, waiting for something to happen. You don't have to be ordered. Sometimes you get to the scene where it's chaotic and you get there, you're like, listen, get over here right now. The police is here. I'm in control. Boom. But then
right,
sometimes
right.
you got to be democratic. Say, hey, well, yo, we're here. What do you think? You know, what happened? You know, so I just don't like to be locked into that one style. What we do know, there's bosses that we
right.
know that was just like autocratic. Boom, 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 boom. All day, every day. It's just not good. So let's talk about training. Let's talk about training, because that's actually the title of the show. We was talking about policies, procedures, and training, but there's some other things we're going to go off on. But let's talk about training. Do you think that the training that's given to officers around the country is adequate? You know, because let me just expand on that. There's been a lot of incidents that's happened. We're going to get into all of that stuff around the country. And the first thing people say is training. And when I say people, I'm talking about the mayor, you know, the police commissioner, they all talk about training. We're going to do more training. And I say, to me, it's like, are you telling us that your training is inadequate? Because you already spent $100,000 on these individuals, giving them training, and as soon as an incident happened, you're saying that the training is inadequate. Because my thought process on the training is actually, I think the training is good all around the country, and there's an issue with other stuff like attitudes. But let's just stay on the training. What do you think about the training? Not that you know about training all over, but it's 2015. The training is what it is. Most people, and we can attest, they come to the NYPD to see what our training is, and the NYPD is the big brother around the country. We got all the toys, but what do you think about the training? Because that's a big issue right now, training.
Well, one of the key pieces with training is it needs to revolutionize with society. Oftentimes, when we look at the wave of innovation in society, such as body cameras, and this is something we can revisit later on throughout the set, but the training needs to maintain a parity with society. If the training does not maintain parity with society, it then becomes archaic. So when we look at what's being the training that's being implemented in police departments, generally speaking, what I see, it's normally a chalk and talk. When I say a chalk and talk, meaning you have an instructor that stands in front of a classroom and states, this is what today's agenda is. They go over a series of agendas. And the officers that come in for this training, they have two main questions. What time is lunch? And what time am I getting out of here? Okay.
Yes.
And so how do you get around that to make these individuals focus? One of the key things that I realize in evaluating training is there should be two components. The first is that chalk and talk, meaning you have the instructor that gives their his or her the tabletop on, okay, this is what we're going over, the Fourth Amendment, etc. How
right.
does the Fourth Amendment work? All right, that's fine. However, there's really no evaluation component that comes into play. When I say an evaluation, meaning, okay, we do the chalk and talk in the beginning, but on the back end, let's have a practical exercise and let's evaluate these individuals. Let's evaluate these officers to see how if they can either prove themselves as satisfactory or unsatisfactory. You know, what is the qualifications in connection with this training? That's the essential piece in training that I see that's missing. It's always been the chalk and talk, and the evaluation piece has been missing. And if you have that in play, then people won't, and everyone, granted, everyone wants to go home early. They right. want a 2-hour lunch break and all. Mm-hmm. I got all of that. We're dealing with human behavior. But however, we need to have that assessment piece in place. That way we can ensure that the officers that do, that are part of this training are 100% and they're capable of implementing the training that they've experienced on the street upon conclusion of this training.
That's great. And, you know, I remember in the early 90s, I had to go to diversity training. I went to diversity training in the police academy. It was right after the Louima incident. Right after the Louima incident, you know, they sent us all. Right. Anytime there's an incident, they send you to train. So they wanted to do diversity training. So I get to this training, it's maybe 50 people in the room. And I'll never forget it because there was a cop that was doing the training. I believe maybe I was a sergeant or a cop at the time. But you had sergeants, cops, lieutenants, captains, up to chiefs in the room. And you had this poor cop doing training. Half the people were asleep. Half the people were on their beepers, you know, right. on their cell phones at the time. And I always used to sit there and be like, damn, they need to have somebody with rank, either training or standing in the room. He has to be the highest ranking person in the room so that everybody else will pay attention.
I can understand that to a point, right? And since then, after Louima, I want to say post-Louima, you've now had the executive development cycles, whereas traditionally the people that are mm-hmm. captains and above, executives in the police department, so to speak,
right.
they do their professional development outside of the lower-ranking members. Right. But you could still have the same scenario because you can have a situation where someone is maybe a 2-star chief. And you can have a sergeant that's actually doing this, that providing this instruction.
Right.
And I can understand where is the focus. I think the key is the trainer. A lot of it is if you have, because I believe anyone can train police officers mm-hmm. if they're competent. It can be a civilian. Mm-hmm. If the civilian's an expert. I mean, if I bring in a subject matter expert on, let's say, the Fourth Amendment or implicit bias for that matter. So I bring in an attorney that discusses how Fourth Amendment search and seizures should be conducted. Although that individual may not be of the same rank as the officers in the room, there will be a respect based on that individual as being a subject matter expert. So that's one piece that's important. Now, also, there needs to be some teeth in this as well. And it goes back to when I mentioned the two-prong approach in training. The chalk and talk in the beginning and the practical assessment on the back end. Because let's say hypothetically everyone is doing like you mentioned when right. you went to train in the past. People are on their beepers, they're falling asleep, mm-hmm. they're out the room for 20 minutes, so on and so forth. Right. That's gonna pay dividends on the back end when we have this assessment phase. And if the individual, meaning the officers that attend this training, do not satisfactorily pass the component of the assessment phase, mm-hmm. then it will do either one or two things. We'll either bring the individual back for retraining or that person could be disciplined, because it's safe to say that the proper tools were presented to that individual and their failure to comply or, you know, gain a grade that was less than satisfactory is something that you have to speak for. Now, the range, the firearms range in the police within the NYPD is run something somewhat similar because
well,
in the beginning, I'm sorry.
You know what? Let's hold that and we'll go to commercial. We'll be back. Corey Pegues Live.
Galaxy Luxury Coach is a full service limousine and party bus company. Family owned and operated, we are an industry leader with over 25 years of experience in providing best-in-class luxury transportation for your special event. Whether it's your precious wedding day, an all-day wine tour out east, your high school prom, that special birthday, or just an amazing night on the town, our professional chauffeurs stand ready to ensure your special event is truly special. Galaxy Luxury Coach has one of the largest and modern party bus fleets in the New York area. Our party buses are simply nightclubs on wheels, concert sound systems, light shows, lasers and strobes, multicolor LED lighting brilliantly lights your party bus inside and out. For corporate and more laid-back events, we will cater to your specific needs and requests. What sets Galaxy aside from all others in the luxury transportation industry is our attention to detail in customizing our services to your special event. At Galaxy, it's all about you and your guests. Galaxy customers return time and time again because they know they can trust Galaxy to help deliver those lifetime memorable moments. Step aboard and let your Galaxy experience begin.
What are you looking for?
You don't even know that. You're
on the ball, so you can't even answer. I'm asking you about it.
You gotta be highly skilled. You understand that?
Nah,
are
you sick?
Are you well versed there? Are you very smart man? Hit me with some funny shit.
My shit's twisted.
Tell me something.
Do you have something right there?
That's awesome.
Well,
that's a big.
That's nice.
You know damn well.
That's awesome.
Sir, are you interested? Are you
twisted
interested
talent.
Or not?
I'm sure. I see you guys twisted.
You understand me? And if you can't whip out answers like that, that man is liable to go on a commercial break, punch your fucking mouth loose. You understand me? Time is up, sir. You understand me? You're on. You're the man. All right, give me your name now. I'm sorry.
My name is Willie.
Willie, where you working at?
We are twisted. We are awesome.
Can you repeat that question again?
Welcome to the Rehab Center, located at 2025 Brentwood Road in Brentwood, New York. At the center, we offer chiropractic services, acupuncture, and physical therapy. We take most major medical, no-fault, and workers' comp insurance. If you need these types of services, contact the offices at 631-234-4949. That's 631-234-4949.
Welcome back to Corey Pegues Live. Again, we have the Dr. Darren Porches, a great retired lieutenant and now doctor who's teaching on a collegiate level right now. Many people don't know. Again, you know, we got promoted to lieutenant together. You helped me get a job. I taught at Monroe College, a few years ago, for a few years, and tried to talk me into going for a PhD, but I had other...
Yeah,
plans.
I talked to you several times about that, actually.
I have a plan. It's still not out the window. Right. I could think about it until I'm 80. But let's go back into the training. You was talking about, like, the firearms training.
Right.
Do you want to expand on that?
Well, traditionally, you have two cycles. And once again, this is centered with the NYPD. Different departments, different municipalities have their own method and means in training their officers. But just central to the NYPD, you have two cycles of training, and generally speaking, the officers need to shoot. There's a qualifying round, and that's a chalk and talk in the beginning, which consists of, you know, a lecture. But it's a lecture, and then on the back end, you have to shoot. You have to shoot the qualifier with your firearm. So let's say hypothetically, an officer fails the qualifier.
So that would be your assessment that you're talking about.
Exactly.
On the other piece.
Exactly.
I got
exactly.
it.
Right.
This guy is good, America. Around the nation, this guy is good. I like it. So chalk and talk to the assessment. Now, I'm going to give you a little pushback because there's been a lot of things going on. And we're going to get into the things that's going on around the country. But again, I'm of the mindset that training cannot change an officer. Because if people have inherent biases, let's use me. I don't eat pork. You're not going to get me to eat pork. I don't care how you disguise it, how much ingredients you put on it. It's not going to happen. As soon as I taste it, I'm going to spit it out. So I say, like, if somebody doesn't like a certain segment of the community, it's just in them. So giving them training, like they sent me to diversity training, it was a joke. I mean, for me, it was a joke because I knew they was talking about, like, Black heritage and, you know, where we come from and this, that, and the other. I already knew that stuff. And other people, like I said, were sleeping, was laughing. So how do we really change the mindset of these cops that's out here committing crimes? And let's just be clear. All cops are not bad. We know that. And I vowed that I wasn't even ever going to say that again because I really feel like I'm playing on people's intelligence by saying all cops not bad. We already know that. But the bad ones are the ones that's rising to the top doing all these things. And the bad thing about policing is when one cop do something bad, the country takes a paintbrush and paint all police officers bad. But again, I'm not of the mindset that the training can change them. We need to do like attitude adjustments. How do you feel about that? And when I say attitude adjustments, before you answer, I say this, you know, I recently just did an interview on BET.com, right? And I said, hey, the only way you're going to change the mindset of these cops are their comrades got to see them being hauled off in handcuffs, right? Getting fired, or actually having some monetary culpability for the stuff that they're doing. And we know that's hard because of unions and contracts and stuff, but maybe the laws need to be changed.
Okay, going back to training, oftentimes whenever it is a snafu or something negative occurs within policing, one of the first platforms that's taken is, look, we need to address this from a training perspective. So professional development is quote-unquote deemed as the quick fix solution. I think the training is necessary. However, it needs to
be... Hold on, let me just interrupt real quick, because after the Eric Garner incident, we'll talk about that later. The NYPD just did all this training. They just retrained everybody. So you was a cop for 20 years. I was a cop for 21 years. Same thing. I went to the academy, and I have no more training after 21 years. Obviously, we had the yearly little BS training, but it's always the quick fix. But throughout the career, people don't get training for the most part.
You bring up an excellent point, and what I was gonna mention was training seems to be the quick fix solution. That's what we want to get in front of this with. We're gonna train everyone to show them how to do the right thing.
Right.
However, what happens is with these trainings, it kind of goes back to what I mentioned to you before. I feel that they're flawed, and it's just the chalk and talk. The evaluation phase is not something that happens on the back end. But just going further, it's not just training. It needs to be a leader-driven solution. Mm-hmm. When I say a leader-driven solution, meaning a leader has to stand in front of this and say, look, I'm going to stand on the building, and this is something that bleeds through my veins. Therefore, this is important to me. If you don't have the leader-driven, if it's not leader-driven, and it coupled with the sustainment piece not being in play, when I say the sustainment piece not being in play, you mentioned before, look, after you come out of the academy, you would get, let's say, car stops, for example. When you went through the police academy, you went through for 6 months, and you went through a segment on car stops. Okay, after you came out of the police academy, training on car stops was few and far between.
Right.
You may have gotten a segment of professional development that addressed car stops, mm-hmm. but it wasn't something that you saw on a normal basis.
Right.
So we think in terms of sustainment. Going back to the what happened with Eric Garner and a lot of these, this amalgamation of different snafus that have happened in policing, and we say to ourselves, training, is this not necessarily fixed? How does this work? It needs to be leader driven, and you have to have a sustainment piece. It's not just a one shot deal. It's something that has to be consistent, and it goes back to what I mentioned earlier. It needs to be concurrent with the innovations in society. When we look at body cameras. Just think about it.
We're going to talk about body cameras. All right.
But just getting back to the training, there needs to be a sustainment piece. It's not, I train you once this year on this particular issue, and then 5 years later when there's a problem, and this is what we get. No, it needs to be something that's ongoing. And once again, the key to it, it must be leader-driven. Not something that just comes from a police academy, but leader-driven as in whatever command that officer is working in has to stand on the building and say, this is what bleeds through my veins, and this is what I want to do.
I love it. Leader-driven. I talk that all the time. Leadership-driven. Okay, let's go into how you feel about having special prosecutors assigned for these police involved in custody and on the street killings around the country. Now, there's a lot of municipalities that have special prosecutors when there's a police involved killing in custody or on the street, but there's a lot of municipalities that don't have it. I mean, I think there should be a federal law, which we know can happen. You know, the states have their own, have to make the decision. But how you feel about a special prosecutor in this lovely state we live in now, New York State? Governor Cuomo just signed the bill for 1 year for any police-involved shooting on the street or killing on the street or in custody. for 1 year trial period. I don't know if you're familiar with this weekend. There was a lady that was found dead in a cell up in Westchester.
Okay, no, I'm not familiar.
Yes, you know, she was in police custody for petty larceny.
In Mount Vernon?
Mount Vernon, Westchester.
Right, right. Okay, I'm familiar with
petty larceny. Right, okay. Came to the precinct. They put her, you know, she was in custody. She complained. They took her to the hospital, brought her back to the hospital. She had the clearance from the doctor, brought her back to the precinct. She's dead as a doorknob now. Dead. So this is the test case for New York State with a special prosecutor. So that's happening here now in New York State. But how do you feel about having a special prosecutor involved in these issues? Again, this is not about cop bashing. One thing I know about police, they are weak. I could say we was cops. Sensitive. Very sensitive. Cops don't want nobody to say anything to them. They know everything, especially when you start getting the unions involved. It's just like cops are right. But it's okay to have a second set of eyes. Because, you know, for the layperson out there, I backed them 100%. How could you trust the cops to investigate along with the district attorney, who they have to speak with every single day to get convictions, and now you're trying to convict the cop? It just doesn't seem right when I take my cop hat off. That's why you have to bring somebody. That's just my opinion. What's yours?
Well, when we think about the usage of a special prosecutor, it can be subjective, and I could see arguments on both sides. This is something that really became paramount in the wake of the death of Eric Garner. And I truly believe that the reason why Governor Cuomo pushed forward to get the legislation in play for the special prosecutor, his basis on this was for votes. And if you think about it, we live in a democratic society. If you had this overall outrage coming from these communities of registered voters that say, look, this is what we want done, then that's what caused him to push forth and sign legislation for the special prosecutor. Going back to this being a democracy, if this is what the public wants, then this is what the public has a right to be entitled to, because at the end of the day, police are public servants. And one thing that's larger than everything here that we didn't really hit on is perception. So the special prosecutor may do nothing, or they may be tremendous. However, the perception of the from the public is, look, something is being done by government to enact certain protocols to ensure that these police-involved shootings or deaths in custodies are being addressed properly. So I'm okay with it based on that. But I will tell you, there's several other things. There's several other entities that focus on these death in custodies, but that's something we can get back to at a later date.
Yes. Great. And with that, let's take another break. You're listening, watching Corey Big East Live television show.
Want a Toyota, but when you want more from your Toyota store, you want Smithtown Toyota, where every Toyota comes with Smithtown Toyota's Toyota for Life program, giving you lifetime New York State inspections, lifetime 10% discounts on all parts and service, 2 years of complimentary oil changes, 2 years of scheduled maintenance, and more, all at no cost to you, plus low clear out deals on every Toyota in stock. Get more from your Toyota store. Hurry to Smithtown Toyota.
After all the candles are blown out, after the last toast of the night, Cambridge paving stones with Armortech stand the test of time. Beautifully designed, built to last. Only Cambridge paving stones have Armortech, our unique process that produces a rich, distinctive color. Create your own memories with Cambridge paving stones. Visit CambridgePavers.com.
Cambridge paving stones with Armortech.
We're back with Dr. Darren Porcher. Okay, Doc. In the last few years, there's been a lot of incidents involving police citizens' encounters resulting in the death of unarmed men and women. What's your take on that? Well, let's go back a little bit to the Eric Garner situation. We know, America knows, the world knows that Officer Pantaleo used a chokehold, which is banned by the NYPD policy and their policies. But I don't think people truly and really understands the difference between it being in the NYPD and being a state law. So can you just break it down so they understand that he violated a police procedure, but it's not against the law to choke somebody?
You bring up a very, very valid point. Police departments across the country they have procedural guidelines. In the NYPD, they have something that's referred to as a patrol guide. And that patrol guide is basically the rules and regulations, the instructions for officers, the regulatory process for officers while they're performing patrol-related duties. That's primarily what they're focused on. One specific component in their states, the chokeholds are banned. And this goes back to years ago, we had a case with a gentleman by the name of Anthony Baez up in the Bronx in the 46th precinct. Right. From that point forward, chokeholds have been banned. Right. So a chokehold is banned on a departmental level. Right. However, on a legal level, it is not banned. So just because someone used a chokehold, that doesn't mean that they will be criminally liable based on the New York State penal law. Right. So you have to understand that there's a difference between the two. When we oftentimes, we look at this and we say, well, the person broke the rules. They could get fired for breaking the rules.
Right.
But the criminal prosecution is not in play. Now, bear in mind, the police department, the NYPD in particular, they have something that's referred to as a trial room. And in that trial room, you have a judge. You actually have a judge. You have a prosecutor.
Yeah, I've been in that trial room.
Right. You have a defense attorney. And it assimilates that of a criminal trial, but it's right. Basically like a deposition, if you want to call it that.
Right.
And that's when that chokehold would be of a genuine issue. Like, look, was this chokehold being used? Yes, this was in violation of the procedural guidelines. And therefore, that individual, Officer Pantaleo, could either lose his job, or he can be disciplined from the perspective of losing vacation days or suspension, etc.
Yes. So there you have it, America. That's the difference between violating the rules and regulations of the patrol guide and the New York State penal law. And just so we all know, we are clear that Officer Pantaleo, his departmental trial hasn't even come up yet. I believe the NYPD, you have like 18 months to do the trial. We're probably approaching about 14 months, so I'm pretty sure his trial will be coming up soon. All right. So let's talk about a couple of these cases. Just yesterday, let's talk about this big case, this huge case, and I definitely want your opinion on it. Gentleman was pulled over in Cincinnati just a month and a half. This is kind of like warp speed, too, with this indictment. He's pulled over, Mr. Sean DuBose, pulled over in Cincinnati. The cop pulls him over, asks him for, in defense of the cop, I looked at that video even before we came here. I looked at it at least 8 times. That video car stop was a textbook. I think we'll agree, textbook all the way until he pulled the weapon. Everything, it was right by the books. He pulled them over for whatever reason. He said the tag was whatever. I give him that.
Front plate was missing.
Front plate's missing. Give him that. And then he started asking further questions. I mean, have your license? This guy's pushing back. You know, it was 3 times. Need your license? He said something. I need your license. He said something. I need your license. Like 3 times. So now at this point, he's like, hey, something going on with this guy. Let me get him out of the car. I don't have a problem with that. But he pulled his gun, and his gun went off. He's going to probably say it was an accidental shooter. When you shoot somebody in the head and kill them, you can't chalk it up as an accident. But how do you feel about that? This is big. An indictment. So now the last 6 months, you have 2 cops in America that's indicted for murder. Not convicted. You know, the Charleston, South Carolina, shot in the back 6 times. North Charleston. And now this. 2 cops. This is like unheard of. Two cops are up for indictments for murder. How do you, like, what's your take on that case?
Well, just I just attribute this to the wave in innovation. When we look at the technology that's in play. The only reason why I'm familiar with this is because the Cincinnati case, the officer was wearing a body camera.
Right.
And when we look at what happened in North Charleston, there was a pedestrian in the street that filmed this with a cell phone video.
Mm-hmm.
So when we look at these incidents, this is what's being highlighted to us by a second source, or a third source, rather. Do I believe that these incidents are problematic? Absolutely, just as we focus on what happened in Cincinnati. The stop, was it justified? Yes, it was justified. The individual, the motorist, he put the key in the ignition and it appeared as if he was looking to try to move away
mm-hmm.
or drive off from the scene.
Right.
And that's when the officer fired a shot, killing the motorist. Now, what's interesting about this scenario is the officer says that he was dragged first.
Right.
And then, in but fear of his life.
Not only dragged, you had a second officer that said that he witnessed the drag.
Right, that concurred with his statements. Now, in defense of the other officer, I don't know what his positioning was. So, now granted, you would have heard, just me thinking from this, as from a Monday morning quarterback perspective,
right.
I'd say, well, you would have heard the shot first, and then the car would have moved. But is it quite possible that the car, he just may not have even been paying attention to this. Oftentimes, the officer could have just been looking anywhere and saw this as a routine stop, and it was really nothing here, because we stopped this person for a front plate that was missing.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know what that officer saw. However, that officer did, when I say that officer, meaning the
You're
second
talking about
officer,
the second officer.
Right, the second officer that we have yet to see in the video.
Right.
The second officer that we've yet to see in the video stated that, yes, he did concur with the officer that fired his weapon, stating that the car pulled off while he was in fear of his life. That's when he shot the individual. It's a real long stretch. And just doing these shootings, I worked in the Internal Affairs Bureau for a number of years,
mm-hmm.
and these types of investigations were things that I managed for years. So I understand, in many instances, how many times can you have two people that see the same thing but give you a different perspective?
Right.
Is that possible?
Mm-hmm.
So what we need to do is we need to really sit down with that officer, and that officer meaning a second officer, and assess where they were positioned, what they were looking at the time of occurrence. Because oftentimes you have officers that one person writes a report and a second officer just says, yeah, I concur, because they don't want to write the report in the first place. Right, but this is problematic behavior. And this
because
needs to
when
be
you have North Charleston, after this guy was murdered, you had the report came out, officers concurred that he pulled his taser out on him.
Right.
Flat out lie.
Once again.
Why? I don't understand why cops, it's this blue wall, me and you know about it, it's this blue wall, everyone wants to fit in, everyone wants to make sure everything is good, but I'm not putting my name on a piece of paper and I know what's wrong. Like, I would never, you know, we was cops. You have your partner write the report and then you sign it. I never did that. Like, if I didn't write it, I'm not signing it. I'll just wait the extra 15 minutes. Let me do my report. Or if you did it, you sign it. But that's the subculture of the police departments around the country, where people are like sick and tired because it gives everybody a black eye. Here's in North Charleston, they murdered this guy, they get the police reports, they said, hey, he pulled the taser out. We clearly saw that he didn't pull a taser out. Now here you have this case in Cincinnati. On this video we have, and there might be another angle, because the defense attorney said yesterday there might be another angle. So the second cop might have saw after the shot, and then the guy running, it could look like he was. So I'll give him that little bit of benefit, but it's only a little bit that I could give, because it's almost like, when you know we go to court and they say you test the lion, you know, these cops go
up together,
getting their story together before they go into the courtroom. Why, with all of this stuff going on, I can't. It's like some of these cops don't even have television. They're not looking at what's going on around America. I just can't for the life of me.
Well, it's a systemic problem within police culture. But I see that this is something that's going to change. Believe it or not. These incidents are on the decrease as opposed to the increase. What happens is it's being spotlighted because everyone has a camera phone. Now we have the ability to see things through an officer's body cam. Mm-hmm. So these incidents are on the decrease. However, it's just being highlighted. And the sensationalism comes into play. When you see that video, the first thing is like, oh, this is crazy. But by and large, that's not the norm for policing within the United States.
Right.
Now, granted, we have some real issues mm-hmm. that need to be fixed. But we also need to take that in consideration that it's not at an increase, but it's at a decrease. But just because it's at a decrease, that doesn't mean that we don't have to do something. We still need to do something. And how do we focus on the systemic problem within police culture? When it, you say in connection with the quote-unquote blue wall of silence,
right.
We must have certain measures in place. We, meaning the public, because the public controls the police department. The police department is a municipality that is paid tax dollars to serve and protect us as a community. We need to implement certain provisions to ensure that these numbers of the amount of misconduct continues to decrease as opposed to increase.
And again, I want to be clear that these cases, there's hundreds of thousands of contacts every day around the country with policing doing good work every single day. And you know, a few of these incidents are being highlighted, but I always like to say, listen, the only person that's trained in any of these police citizens encounters are the cops. They get extensive training. So we have to almost bat 100 every single time we go out the door. Cops can't afford to bat 99 because 1%, you could kill somebody. That, like, you have to always check your attitude at the door. I would turn my troops out, check your attitude at the door. Meanwhile, I just, you know, I had an argument with my wife. And after coming to work and handle a domestic dispute, like, it's a tough job, you know. I mean, right. We was there. It's a tough job being a police officer, but they have to bat 100%. And, you know, being an executive, I would, you know, review these cases, shootings and stuff. And if the guy was just out there, the cop, doing the right thing, and they made a mistake of the heart is fine. It's a mistake of the head. When you think about it and you actually do it, then you should be held accountable for your actions. You should definitely be held accountable for your actions. And we'll go to a commercial break one more time. You're listening to Corey Pegues Live and actually viewing with Dr. Darren Porcher. See you on the turnaround.
I think this is a good time to tell you. You're doing okay, Mom. I can call you Mom, right? I know we haven't known each other very long, but you seem like a real keeper. You're not perfect. There was that strained carrots incident. But you're trying. You pick up my bottle every time I toss it out of my stroller. That's high comedy to an 8-month-old. You hum the Barber of Seville when you wash my hair. So cool. And your rubdowns are out of this world. Anyway, I want you to know how much I appreciate you. You know, right? How much I love you? You're doing okay, Mom. I think this is a good time to tell you. You're doing okay, Mom. I can call you Mom, right? I know we haven't known each other very long, but you seem like a real keeper. You're not perfect. There was that strained carrots incident, but you're trying. You pick up my bottle every time I toss it out of my stroller. That's high comedy to an 8-month-old. You hum the Barber of Seville when you wash my hair. So cool. And your rubdowns are out of this world. Anyway, I want you to know how much I appreciate you. You know, right? How much I love you? You're doing okay, Mom.
Stretching under sedation or manipulation under anesthesia is a very gentle very precise procedure to very slowly release any scar tissue that is formed as a result of a traumatic injury. Many people ask, how does this work? Will I get hurt? Will you stretch me too far? We only stretch the body part to its normal range of motion. After completing the post-MUA rehabilitation program, it's very common that our patients say to us, hey, I can play ball with my kid again. Hey, I can bowl again. Hey, I can enjoy hiking again. This is what makes it rewarding to us as practitioners.
Welcome back. We're having a great discussion with Dr. Darren Porcher, retired lieutenant in the New York City Police Department and now professor at several college universities in New York. Okay, this segment, let's talk about, well, before we do that, I have this email. Well, I have people email me at askcorypickies@gmail.com, and I got a couple of questions from Roy Kahn for you. Okay, he sent me a couple of questions. Just for you. The police in this country seem to be trained to aim at the so-called area of critical mass, which we know what that is, shoulders to about your hip. Why is training not varied vis-a-vis the situation as it seems to be done in Britain and elsewhere?
That's a good point. The reason why officers are trained to shoot a center mass, because when you look at a department of 30,000 plus members, not everyone is a marksman. Some people shoot better than others. Center mass is the largest part of the body, so it's the easiest part to hit. Oftentimes people say, why don't you shoot somebody in the arm? Why don't you shoot them in the leg? The goal is to shoot to terminate the assault, or to terminate the force.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what the goal is. It's not to shoot to kill. It's shoot to terminate the force. And that's the easiest part of the body to hit. When we talk about shooting someone in the arm, let's say hypothetically, I shoot somebody in the arm. That person can still shoot you with their other arm. The same holds true with being shot in the leg. A headshot is a very difficult shot to make. So that center mass, we go back to center mass, that's the easiest part of the body to hit. Now, other departments may have different means and methods in training people, and that may be well, but there's no police department that's the size of the NYPD. So you have to take in consideration what the mean officer's capability with a firearm is, and that's why they focus on center mass.
Okay, great. Second question, is there strategic training that given to every officer, that's given to every officer, and if not, why? Logically, it seems that employing tactics without strategy is a recipe for disaster. If this training is given, how often is it refreshed?
That goes back to the firearms training cycle that officers, and I can speak for the NYPD. Traditionally, biannually, meaning officers attend firearms training twice a year, and those two components are addressed in that firearms training cycle twice a year. Now, once again, you have some officers that are better than others. There's a mean score that they need to score in order to maintain a level of proficiency. And outside of that, I can't really see much more. I think the firearms training should be more progressive, because when we look in the grand scheme of things, from like when I became a cop, and I'm sure you can attest to this, 20 years, I didn't see much of the deviation from when I was in the police academy to 20 years later, just before I retired.
Yeah.
So I agree, there needs to be a progression in the firearms training.
Okay, and Roy had one question for me. The Cleveland City Police Department seems to be involved in a lot of police misconduct. Given that a consent decree was signed between the Department of Justice and them, what do you think of the consent decrees? Well, consent decrees, there's at least a dozen police departments around the country under the consent decree from the Department of Justice, just a town over from here.
The federal
county.
Monitors.
Yeah, the federal monitors. But a lot of these departments are under federal monitoring for years, and nothing happened. Like I said, just over here in Nassau County, they're under the consent decree for like the last 10 years. Ferguson, I believe they were under a federal consent decree before this even
LAPD.
Happened. LAPD. So it's,
they just completed the consent decree.
My opinion on consent decrees are like a piece of paper, but I haven't really seen any meat and teeth in these where they're drastically changing these departments or giving them sanctions for the things that they've been doing. But thanks for your questions, Roy. And anybody else want to ask a question, you can email me at askcoreypeguese@gmail.com. That's askcoreypeguese@gmail.com. But let's get back to this. And it seems as if the entire country, for the most part, are going toward body cameras. And you were speaking about that earlier. I said I wanted to get your opinion on that. How do you feel about body cameras?
I think body cameras are good, but it's not a one-fix solution.
Right.
It's a cog in the mechanism of change. Because mm-hmm. let me give you an example. We look at Eric Garner, for example. That was something that was done with a cell phone.
Right.
And so would you say that has the equivalent magnitude of a police body camera? I think so, because it allowed us as the general public to view what occurred on the street that day. So I think that, and what was the end result? You got no indictment, and now people can say that that was subjective, because I can see arguments on both sides. I can see people that say, look, you know what, I can understand why there was no indictment, and I can see people, the vast majority of the public, saying that this is ridiculous, this is an outrage, it should have been an indictment. You have to look at the legal process. It wasn't so much as the district attorney, Dan Donovan, doing a horrible job, which people thought. You have to look at what the makeup of those charges consisted of. That's what the issue there was. I'm sorry. Bigger than all of that, with these body cameras, it's one cog in the mechanism of change, because it needs to be monitored appropriately. And what I don't hear is there's no tabletop connected with this. I think a great thing to a great component to add into these body cameras is once a week, a supervisor sits down and reviews the body cameras, the actions that officers have partaken in throughout the course of the week.
Right.
And then have a tabletop. Let's make this a training venue.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this is what Officer Porcher did this week. Let's see how he focused on his car stop. Pros and cons. That is a very essential component in this, and that's not there. It's just, we're going to turn these cameras on and we'll see what it shows us. I'm sorry.
Okay, with about a few minutes left, what, if anything, can be done to bridge the gap between policing and the black community?
Well, policing in the communities of color is not just the African-American community, but you have to also, the Latino community is experiencing
I call them black.
Well, I mean,
that's the same.
I mean, that's your assessment.
Because when you say minority, you're talking about East Indian, you're talking about Asians, it's everybody. But okay, issues are
the minority community and the police department. I think that the police, oftentimes I hear police, and I worked in the Community Affairs Bureau for a number of years, the police are deemed as the avid professionals. And they have to do whatever it takes to overcome these hurdles of resistance within the community, to partner, to engage in these partnerships. Some years ago, I remember the chief of the Community Affairs Bureau had a great solution, but it was, once again, the leadership didn't get in front of it. And it has to be a leader-driven strategy to step to the community. And
well,
the police department's not doing that.
Dr. Porcher, I really appreciate you coming on, being our first guest, Corey Pegues Live. How can people contact you? Social media?
Yeah, you can contact me on Twitter at Dr. Darren Porcher at Twitter. And that's probably the best way that you can make connection with me. And I'm more than happy to address any issues in connection with criminal justice related instances. And I can give you my answers on this. But once again, I'm truly happy to be here today. And congratulations on your new show. I know that this is going to be a success. This is just the beginning.
Thank you. And you can contact me at Twitter at CPEGUES or also Facebook, Corey Pegues Live. And you can or ask Corey Pegues or email me with any questions at askcoreypegues@gmail.com. Stay tuned for Monday, August 3rd, my radio show, Corey Pegues Live Radio Show. We have Darren Green, Dennis Jones, and Valerie McFadden talking about gun and gang violence in and around the Long Island region. And next Thursday, we'll have in studio Dr. Karen Kenniston talking about health issues. Thanks again for coming. Oh, got to shout my sponsors out. Whitney E. Johnson Foundation Incorporated, Roger and Shavonna Johnson Sr., CEO and CFO of All About Us Youth Magazine and executive producers of AAU TV. Again, thanks for watching Corey Pegues Live, where I keep it right, not real.